Greetings, students, well-wishers, interested parties, and hangers-on. This is session 4 of Biblical Themes in Cinema Through the Decades. This is a mini-course at the Rohrer Center of Camden County College. The film under discussion for this session is Finding Nemo. And my name is Grant Gieske. This is a course for the spring 2020 term. We were able to have 3 in-person sessions before the world changed, and sessions 4 and 5 will be conducted in this format on this online portal. Please join us. It should be noted at the outset that the following session is rated G for general audiences and all ages. It's also worth noting that this is the only one of our sessions for this mini course that is rated G. You may recall that Raiders of the Lost Ark was rated PG, despite how that movie traumatized a generation of young children, myself included, and along with a few other movies in the early 80s, led to the establishment of the PG-13 rating. You may also recall that we had a discussion about the language in the film Pulp Fiction, and how that film earned its hard R rating thoroughly. For now, it's probably sufficient to say that this sweet father-son tale has some very scary moments, and we're borrowing that description from this website, Common Sense Media, and we'll return to this website in a bit. Despite that disclaimer, the more interesting thing about this review, I noticed that a review of the film Finding Nemo is written by a person named Nell Minow. Not spelled the same, but in any event, the wonders never cease. So, now to review a few things that I shared in class, just as a way of rounding out some biographical information about me. I grew up in Kansas City, Missouri. My educational background is as a religious scholar, and I've always been interested in how religion and popular culture relates, particularly movies, and I've maintained that interest throughout my education and teaching. The first movie I can remember seeing in the theater as a kid was Return of the Jedi, which is not that bad of a film to remember as my first. The last movie I saw was the film Barcelona. And now this is the second film in a sort of unofficial trilogy of movies, all written and directed by Whit Stillman. These films are Metropolitan, Barcelona, and The Last Days of Disco, which were all released in the 1990s. Of these, Metropolitan is my favorite. In fact, it's one of my favorite films of all. My favorite movie of all is the movie Goodfellas. There are movie franchises such as The Godfather Part 1 and 2, excluding Part 3, that are hugely significant. There are sequences that I love dearly, such as the boat sequence of Jaws, but my favorite movie, front to back, is Goodfellas. The takeaway that I have hoped to attain from this course is to find out how the students who were engaging the material were making meaning out of the films. It's my perspective that people are always interpreting, always making meaning out of the films they watch, the books they read, anything they're exposed to, really. And what I wanted to do was tap into some of the ways that people were already making meaning instead of simply presenting an interpretation of a movie. The goal was to find a sort of connection to something in the Bible and use that as a way to unlock different perspectives and different processes that people use to figure out what they think about what they're watching and how they sort of put that meaning together in their own lives in some semblance of a community. And to that end, we have information about you that we shared in class. We talked about, each person talked about their upbringing, where they were from, their education, their occupation. We talked about your movies, the first movie you saw, the last movie you had seen, your favorite movies. We also talked about some of your favorite movies in particular genres. We talked about thrillers in relation to the movie Get Out, for instance. And so again, we got to talking about your process of meaning making, which I found fascinating. And this is the kind of conversation I would love to continue on this online portal if those who watch are able to comment and weigh in. And in class, we were also able to check in, just share a little bit of personal information about our lives and what was going on. And this is another thing that I would love to continue, and I would love to hear from you, not just what you think about the films and how you interact with the material, but how you're doing in your life. It's quite a unique time in history, and I'm concerned about everyone. I hope everyone is doing well. Please, if you have the opportunity to check in, tell us how you're doing personally. We hope that everyone is doing well, of course. And it's worth reiterating the spoiler policy that we advanced in class, that if a movie needed to be spoiled in order to make a point in a discussion, if a movie was released in the prior millennium, in the 20th century, then the spoilers could fly free. However, we did want to maintain a sort of policy of discretion of spoiling any movie, particularly a recent movie, with anything pertinent, unless it's absolutely necessary to make a point. Now, it should be noted that Finding Nemo will be discussed at length and thoroughly spoiled here. So this lecture and all the lectures in this mini session are predicated on the idea that you have watched the movies beforehand. It will be much more interesting and worthwhile for you to have watched Finding Nemo before you view the remainder of this slideshow. As far as my personal policy and preference on spoilers, I want to know nothing except one piece of information, and that is the year a movie came out. I have a strong desire to make up my own mind and decide for myself what I think of the movies I watch, and that is why I try to avoid spoilers that would prejudice me in one direction or another. The reason I do want to know when a movie came out, however, is based on my practice of going to see movies without knowing a whole lot about them back when I was a teenager. And if you're wondering if somebody could be in a theater and know nothing about a movie except that it was a recent movie, not even know the name of the movie, I can tell you exactly how that happened to me one time. It actually happened in the year 2001. I looked up the date. I got wind of a sneak preview of a movie at my local Cineplex in Florida where I was going to college, and it was for the movie Heartbreakers, which turned out to be not that terrible of a movie. It starred Sigourney Weaver and Gene Hackman, and it was surprisingly funny, and it was fine. However, the first time I attempted to see the movie was at the sneak preview, but after the first reel, there was a problem with the projector, and everything broke down. After a lengthy delay, the theater manager came out and explained that the movie just wasn't going to work, and in its place, they would show something else just as soon as they could get another movie ready and spun on the reel. As it happened, the movie started to roll without any announcement of what it was, and so an audience that had come to see Heartbreakers ended up seeing a movie that ran in its place, and this movie was Memento. And if you've seen the movie Memento, you can probably appreciate just how disorienting it was to have watched the first reel of Heartbreakers and then to watch the movie Memento and have my mind blown by it. So my reaction to this movie was, what the? Anyway, we can now use this opportunity to talk a little bit about the movie industry at this point when Finding Nemo came out. So we can consider the decade of the 2000s. This is the year 2000 through 2009. As a time in which the movie industry was changing fairly rapidly, but not super rapidly. It was a decade in which the movie studios and the film industry sort of dug in, felt like they wanted to just enjoy the gains they had made in the 1990s. And so it was, as an industry, quite slow to respond to a number of developments. The first being the rise of the internet. So what had been mainly a sort of hobby was now becoming a pastime for people as the 90s turned into the 2000s. And so people were spending time surfing the web and using the internet, which started to cut into the leisure time that they would have otherwise devoted to things like movies. And so not only did the internet take off as a way for people to spend their time, but e-commerce followed quickly behind. And in terms of people buying movies on the internet, the industry was incredibly slow to respond to what Chris Anderson called the long tail. Chris Anderson was the editor-in-chief of Wired magazine and talked about how in the future, companies and industries would not sell more of less, would not sell more copies of a handful of big movies and albums and books, that it would be selling less of more, that it would be selling a handful of copies of a vast library of content. So here is what Anderson wrote in 2004, the same year that Finding Nemo came out. He wrote, quote, "Almost anything is worth offering on the off chance it will find a buyer. This is the opposite of the way the entertainment industry now thinks. Today, the decision about whether or when to release an old film on DVD is based on estimates of demand, availability of extras such as commentary and additional material, and marketing opportunities such as anniversaries, awards, and generational windows. Disney briefly re-releases its classics every 10 years or so as a new wave of kids come of age. It's a high bar, which is why only a fraction of movies ever made are available on DVD. That model may make sense for the true classics, but it's way too much fuss for everything else. The long tail approach, by contrast, is to simply dump huge chunks of the archive onto bare-bones DVDs without any extras or marketing. Call it the Silver Series and charge half the price. Same for independent films. In a long-tail economy, it's more expensive to evaluate than to release. Just do it." End quote. So, here, 15 years ago, Anderson foresaw the way a company like Netflix does business, which is essentially to buy a piece of intellectual property and figure out what it is afterwards. the studios were slow to recognize how things were changing in this way, and they were still attempting to make mass market tentpole movies, movies that could attract a wide swath of the intended audience. These are called four quadrant movies, which illustrate how the movie industry slices their audience between male and female and those who are under 25 and over 25. Most movies fall squarely into one quadrant. However, a tentpole movie, a movie that is meant to appeal to all audiences, is said to be a four-quadrant movie that can appeal across these demographic barriers. And it is worth pointing out that Pixar has done this with remarkable effectiveness. On the DVD box for Finding Nemo that I have, there is a blurb from Leonard Maltin, the movie critic who always has a blurb. And what he said about Finding Nemo is, unlike any movie you've ever seen, you could be 5 or 95 and you'll enjoy this film, end quote. And between the ages of 5 and 95 definitely suggests that a family film can be that four-quadrant movie. And certainly the Pixar films had discovered this in the 90s and gotten the ball rolling, but really found themselves at the apex of this industry in this decade. This was also the decade in which the international markets just became too important to ignore. Now, to think about this, try to remember a time before Pixar was ascendant. And the original Toy Story came out in 1995. It was an across-the-boards blockbuster. It was a critical phenomenon, and it connected with audiences as an absolute blockbuster. It raked in $146 million in the U.S. alone. It qualified as the number three movie in terms of its domestic gross box office that year. However, in terms of the international markets, Toy Story was edged out by Die Hard with a Vengeance that year, which was the third entry in the Die Hard franchise. And recall that Toy Story had just released its original film, whereas Die Hard was a franchise that was already well known overseas at that point. And so this underscores how existing intellectual property became the hottest commodity for these international markets, because it was easier to market a movie that people already knew about, characters audiences were already familiar with, as opposed to introducing a new concept out of whole cloth. And this started a trend that would come into full flower in the 2010s, where any existing intellectual property would simply be bought up by the studios and released to critical indifference and middling box office returns in the United States. But these movies would do better overseas because they would not have to be marketed as aggressively, as opposed to movies that were invented out of whole cloth and had to be sold to audiences without any prior orientation to the concept or any expectations. So Hollywood essentially took the approach that had worked for them in the previous decade and just doubled down on it. The movie industry had made so much money from the rental and sale of VHS tapes in the 90s, the same way it had been buoyed by licensing movies to television and cable in the 80s, that the industry just wanted to protect the gains it had made. And so they just transitioned the VHS cassette to the digital video disc, the DVD. And as Anderson noted in the excerpt of that article I read earlier, many of these were simply dressed up reissues of older movies, and there had begun to be a trickle of special features included on DVDs of current movies that were released. So this comes into play in terms of the aftermarket of DVDs, because this is the copy of Finding Nemo that I own. And I actually found it at a thrift store. This is the tag still on it from Goodwill for $1.99. And as I recall, I saw the movie in a stack of DVDs. I thought that price was too good to pass up to have this DVD for my kids. And so I just threw it in my cart and purchased it. It wasn't until I got home that I actually opened it, which I should have done in the thrift store. And what I found was one disc instead of the two-disc collector's edition I was expecting, with this handwritten label, which at the top says Finding Nemo Bonus Disc. And I thought, here I'm only getting the bonus features. I'm not getting the movie itself. And then I wondered who or what is Mel. And I'm still wondering that today. What I found, however, when I put the DVD in my DVD player is that it worked. It was a copy of the Finding Nemo movie itself. As it happened, it was a semi-legal version produced by a company called 321 Studios, who had developed a software for ripping DVDs, for taking DVDs that had copy protection on them and extracting the movie such that the consumer could turn around and burn their own DVDs. And this DVD works to this day in the DVD players I still have functioning around the house. Now, as we tended to do in our sessions, we will show a scene from Finding Nemo as our entry point into the movie. And this is an excerpt from the beginning of the movie. This is pre-title sequence, what we're about to see. And so the first scene of Finding Nemo is a scene in which we will be losing Coral. And that is all the introduction that we need.
What?
You remember how we met?
Well, I try not to.
Well, I remember. Excuse me, miss. Can you check and see if I have a hook in my lip?
Marlin!
Oh, you gotta look closer because it's way in here.
Get away from me!
Here he is! Cutie's here! Where did everybody go? Get inside the house, Coral. No, no, Coral, don't. They'll be fine. Just get inside, you, right now. It's okay. Daddy's here. Daddy's got you. I promise I will never let anything happen to you. Nemo.
So,
if you'll forgive the expression, you're sort of thrown into the deep end of the ocean, so to speak, as a viewer here, immediately, as even before the opening credits roll in this film. Now, Pixar would go on to do this again even more memorably a few years later with the movie Up, in which a character dies early on in that movie. And this is contrary to the established pattern of sentimental tearjerker movies, when characters typically only die once the audience has had time to emotionally invest in that person. Instead, immediately you're thrown into the deep end because you don't know anything about these characters. They appear on the screen, and all of a sudden, one of them is gone, and life goes on in the movie with that loss as a sort of important motivation for the characters who remain. Now, it should be noted that not long after this movie came out, even, and for years afterwards, there was a sort of backlash to what happened in the beginning of Finding Nemo. And here we can return to common sense media. And we can return to Nell Minow as review. But we can also look at these two user reviews. And these, to this day, are the top reviews, user reviews on this site, Common Sense Media. And so two parents have commented here. And the first one is, I can't trust Disney anymore. I can't believe Disney did this. And the other is, my four-year-old was traumatized. So if this was your only exposure to this movie, you might think that this movie was a debacle. You might think that this movie just traumatized young children, and you might wonder to what end. It should be noted what a massive across-the-board hit this was with critics and audiences. This movie grossed $871 million. It was a screaming success, even by Pixar's lofty standards. And this sort of underscores the fact that you can have a tentpole, four-quadrant movie designed to appeal to everyone from the age of 5 to 95 and still find those who are dissatisfied by it. Particularly those who are just outside the age range and said that their four-year-old was traumatized by watching it. Perhaps the same thing happened to 96-year-olds. We'll never know, but they're free to post on Common Sense Media and tell us about how they didn't like the movie. But by and large, the consensus was that everyone else did like this movie. However, this is a pivotal choice that the filmmakers made to include this in a pre-title sequence, this death in a children's movie. And we can see some of the interaction with that idea and the backlash here from The Simpsons. This is an episode from 2011, about 7 years after Finding Nemo came out. It's an episode called Homer Scissorhands. And this is a scene between Bart and his friend Milhouse on the playground in which this phenomenon, this scene, is discussed. So let's watch it.
As Wasn't this the greatest day ever?
There are no more great days, Bart. Just days.
What's wrong, man?
Something happened last night. Something that really changed me. My mom put in the Finding Nemo DVD, but then she got a phone call, so I started it myself. Did you know it has a chapter before chapter two? A chapter where we meet Nemo's mother.
Nemo doesn't have a mother.
Not after chapter one, he doesn't.
I know.
If death can happen to a fish, it can happen to anyone. So you've got to live life while you can. So I'm gonna finally proclaim my love for Lisa.
That's your takeaway from Nemo? I think you've already made your feelings for Lisa clear.
Well, I can make them more clear. You see, in the past, I've been too subtle. It's my curse. Subtlety!
So, here we have a humorous grappling with a real issue, and that is the issue of exposing children to traumatic events such as a death in the family, the death of a parent, the death of a mother, which is an event just dropped into the movie right at the start, forcing the children who saw it to grapple with that immediately. And it also speaks to the ways in which we sort of hack movies for our own ends. We watch them in the way we choose, and we can do a sort of end run around the way the movies were originally presented. So when the movie came out on DVD, parents had the option of skipping the opening chapter, and The Simpsons acts as if this is a common practice among parents, which you can tell by Bart Simpson's reaction to of befuddlement that Nemo doesn't even have a mom, because presumably his mother showed him the same the DVD in the same way, excluding this all-important pivotal first chapter. And I do recall reading an article in Slate about how years ago about how parents would show the movie Mary Poppins to their kids and would skip past these sort of important but boring parts in the beginning just to get on to the singing and the wonderful plot points of Mary Poppins, but sort of leaving out some of the early establishing scenes, one of which keys on suffrage for women as a sort of important issue that's presented amongst the family, and that the way that parents tend to show their kids changed the movie and eliminated these themes that the filmmakers had included, presumably for some important purpose. Now, it leads us to think about these issues in sort of a larger context, and here, this artwork is from Rembrandt, and it depicts Abraham and Isaac. That's the title of the artwork. This is from the 17th century. We'll see this and another sort of Renaissance era painting, another depiction of a biblical scene from Genesis in just a moment. But here we can bring in the Bible as a way to change our perspective and try to put things in a different sort of larger context here. When we think about children and trauma and how that is depicted. So what is depicted in this painting is the Akedah, which is the binding of Isaac. That phrase is often misunderstood to mean that the sacrifice of Isaac. However, it refers to the binding of Isaac, the preparation made by his father Abraham to sacrifice him, to kill him. Of course, if you want to review the story in the book of Genesis now, you will find that that does not happen, that that event is preempted at the last moment in dramatic fashion. But here we have an incredibly important and influential depiction in the Bible that has been grappled with by interpreters, religious people, philosophers, since the idea that God commanding a man to sacrifice, kill his own son, and everything that that says about God, everything that that says about humanity in terms of Abraham's response, in terms of Isaac's participation in this process. But what is crucial in the way we're looking at it in this context, thinking about Finding Nemo and how one parent is left behind to raise Nemo and cope with the loss of his wife, the loss of Nemo's mother in this opening scene, is that Abraham's wife Sarah is absent from this episode. Now, this of course is a symptom of a larger problem in the Bible, and we can speak about the Bible in this general term in this instance, because what we're talking about is the marginalization of female characters. So Sarah is present in the narrative, the sort of Abraham patriarchal story, the literal patriarchal story, the story of the biblical patriarchs from the very beginning. Sarah is present, and yet she is a marginal figure at best, and this is exemplified in no stronger terms than in the Akedah, in which Sarah is just absent in this whole process. And so what you have here is the depiction of the biblical depiction of a family in which the mother is marginal and ultimately absent during this incident. And I feel like that's a crucial piece of information to consider when we interpret all of this, and even when we consider that Pixar, as phenomenally successful as they were, and as powerfully as their films connected, critics began to write, even by the time of Finding Nemo, about Pixar's problem with with the female characters depicted in their films. Basically, Pixar was centered on its male characters. Its heroic male characters were the centerpiece of the film, and its female characters were marginal. Now, this is typified in my mind by the movie Cars, in which the cars are the main characters, of course, and yet they are gendered. There are male and female cars, if you will. And Cars was such a boys' movie. It was marketed to boys, and the merchandising that was marketing to boys was just ubiquitous for practically a generation. For years after, you could find Cars merchandise at stores, and then at discount stores, and then at thrift stores. Cars was just everywhere, and so you essentially had Pixar flooding the merchandising market with boys' stuff. This was marketed as boys' toys and boys' gear, and Cars was for boys. And it wasn't until the movie Brave came out a few years after that, that Pixar had its first female hero, its first female main character, protagonist. And despite that movie's failure to connect with audiences the same way the other Pixar movies had connected, Pixar eventually made the movie Frozen, which did the same thing as the Cars did for boys, for girls, for young women. Frozen merchandise was just ubiquitous and remains so to this day, due to the recent sequelization of Frozen in the form of Frozen 2. And actually, when we started class and had our first session, my answer to the last movie I had seen was Frozen 2, which I had seen with my daughters the previous night. So let's turn from focusing mainly on Nemo's father, Marlin, and thinking about the parents' role in these relationships to thinking about the role of the children. We've already considered how children may have been traumatized by watching Finding Nemo and seeing this opening scene of Nemo's mother killed and disappeared from the movie before the credits even start to roll. But we can think about how this movie speaks to children and what kind of work it's doing to interact with their own framework and their own background of how they see the world, nascent as it is, as children. And for here we can turn to the work of a European film theorist, Torben Grodal, and particularly his book Embodied Visions, Evolution, Emotion, Culture, and Film. In that book and elsewhere, he argues that Finding Nemo really speaks to the sense of the fears that are baked into the mind of a child based on evolution. And so this really appeals to the fears children have sort of naturally developed as a result of evolution, particularly in this system of hazard precaution, of building up safeguards and precautions to dangerous situations they will encounter in later life, such as the intrusion of a malevolent force, just like the fish who shows up to kill, presumably, and take away Coral, Nemo's mother, in the opening sequence of the film. And so what films like this do is to teach children how to build precautions against that. And so one thing that children are encouraged to do by films like this is to bond with their parents. That films like this tend to develop a strong endorsement of parental agency and parental authority. And we see throughout the film that Marlin, Nemo's father, has sort of overlearned this lesson, has becomes overprotective of Nemo based on the trauma that he suffered. But because Nemo did not suffer it, because it happened before he was born, he does not share that sense of trauma and begins to rebel against that, begins to test those limits in the first act of the film. And it is this kind of relationship that needs to be worked out over the course of the movie. Another lesson that films like this often teach as a way of safeguarding against these hazards is the development of friendship. And as a sort of major spoiler alert here, what ultimately happens is that Nemo is lost and then found, Finding Nemo, based not only on the actions and the heroic quest of Marlin, but of a friend that he makes, another fish named Dory, as well as a sort of community of turtles and seagulls and animals who all band together on the one hand to break Nemo out of the prison of the dentist's aquarium where he eventually finds himself confined, and also helps Marlin cross an ocean to find Nemo. And so this movie sort of illustrates how children develop these processes to safeguard against these dangerous things that may happen to them. And we can see this again in the book of Genesis, turning to the story of Lot and his daughters. Now, Lot has a couple of sort of intersecting storylines, and this is a depiction of Lot and his daughters by an Italian Renaissance painter, Francescino. And this is, again, a part of the 17th century explosion of Renaissance art that is interested in depicting some of the more notorious moments of the Bible. We had the Akedah a few moments ago, and now we have this depiction of Lot and his daughters. And this is part of sort of two stories that are presented together in Genesis. The first is when angels appear in the city of Sodom, where Lot lives, and are ultimately show up to destroy the city. They are shown hospitality by Lot, but the men of the city of Sodom, the Sodomites, demand to have sex with the angels. And in a long story short kind of way, Lot and his family are able to escape the city just prior to its destruction. However, they are told not to look back. Lot's wife, however, does look back and becomes a pillar of salt. Now, we should note that before we turn to this story, that Lot initially tried to offer his daughters to the men of Sodom, claiming that they were virgins and that the men could have their way with them as an alternative to try to have sex with these angels that have shown up, but that this offer is refused. Now, after the destruction of the city of Sodom and after Lot's wife is killed by being turned to salt, Lot finds himself in a cave with his daughters, and the depiction shown here in this painting is Lot's daughters getting him drunk so that they may have sex with him in order to produce offspring. And so again, you have an extraordinarily dysfunctional parental relationship with children here that is sort of centered around death, as with the Akedah, but also incest. Basically, the Bible, the book of Genesis, sort of going at a number of taboos simultaneously. And it sort of speaks to how the marginalization of female characters again turns these narratives on their ear, and the absence of one of the parents of these children, in both cases the mother of the children, as the Bible is wont to do by marginalizing or just excluding depictions of female characters altogether, how things go awry in this manner. And it causes us to reflect on how the resources that children are able to turn to can become productive forces in their life, the development of friendship and their bond to their parents becomes a way to safeguard against tragedies. But in terms of the traumas that are already inflicted, there are shown a number of different strategies here to cope with that. But again, Finding Nemo takes a different tack. And particularly I'm thinking here of the friendship, the relationship that forms between Marlin and Dory. And crucially, Dory's defining character trait is her forgetfulness. And so, as a response to trauma, Dory's strategy of simply forgetting things and just moving on to the next thing in front of her is crucial. It forms what is essentially the tagline of the film Finding Nemo, which is "just keep swimming," as we will see in this scene right here.
Hey, Mr. Grumpy Gills. When life gets you down, you know what you gotta do?
I don't wanna know what you gotta do.
Just keep swimming, just keep swimming, just keep swimming, swimming, swimming. What do? We swim, swim.
Dory, no singing.
Oh, 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 oh,
Dory.
I love to swim in.
Dory.
When you want to swim, you want
See,
to
See, I'm gonna
keep
get stuck now with that song. Now it's in my head.
Sorry.
So, what we see in this scene and illustrated throughout the entire film is Dory's forgetfulness is one strategy that Marlin is presented with to cope with the tragedy of losing his wife due to her death, and losing his son due to his son being lost. He can just simply forget about it and just keep swimming. Now, this is presented in an empowering way that he needs to keep swimming onto the next task of finding Nemo, as opposed to just forgetting about the whole thing and trying to live a comfortable life without his son and just become resigned to how his son has been taken from him. However, it does speak to the powerful relationship between trauma and memory and different ways of coping with that. Just trying to forget about it is a fairly negative message when presented in this way, particularly when juxtaposed with what we read in the Bible and how these horrific stories end up having consequences and end up changing the relationship between characters as the narrative unfolds. So you could argue that it would be impossible to truly forget about things that had happened to these characters, water under the bridge, because what is past is prologue, and this background, particularly in the Hebrew Bible, tends to find its way into the foreground yet again. And this is based on something we mentioned in class, the essay Odysseus's Scar by the scholar Eric Auerbach. And this notion of the Hebrew Bible as distinct from the New Testament as being replete and laden with this kind of background that is always there, that frequently intrudes into and colors the foreground of whatever narrative you are reading. And we should also note, as a sort of postscript, that this movie's sequel, Finding Dory, reveals that Dory's forgetfulness and her entire character is based on her being separated from her parents at a very young age, just the same way Nemo was separated from his parents. So at the root of Dory's memory problem, again, is this trauma. And so even the sequels are playing with this idea in an interesting way. And yet, when we interpret it in this way, it comes off as a fairly negative message that what we should simply do with trauma and with difficulties in our lives is just forget them and move on to the next thing, just keep swimming. Now, it is better to cast this in the light of the plot of the film and say you must keep swimming towards a solution to the problem, towards finding Nemo, towards restoring or recreating what was lost. And that's closer to the other larger message of the film, which also speaks to this sort of evolutionary basis that the film appeals to in the minds of its young viewers, which is the development of friendship and the development of a community of people in Marlin's life that are able to help him find Nemo. He had become so frightened of the outside world that he had closed off his own world with himself and Nemo and no one else, essentially. And Marlin learns to trust Dory and to open himself up and trust other fish in the sea, other animals, who are able to help him find Nemo. And that is a more empowering interpretation of the film, I feel, and one that we may be able to get behind and sort of co-sign more enthusiastically. So this essentially wraps up the initial conversation I wanted to have about the film Finding Nemo. Hopefully we can continue this conversation and advance some other interpretations, make some more meaning out of this movie. This is never presented as the end-all be-all. It's just a way to connect what we know about the Bible and these movies, which have become a sort of cultural canon for us, to think about them in different ways and to get the ball rolling about the different ways we can interpret and make meaning out of these. To that end, I would now offer some shameless self-promotion. If things are going to proceed. The next mini course I will be able to teach is on the Vietnam War in cinema. And I will just list the sessions that are proposed if we're able to do this class, presumably in an online format. And so these are the five films for the five sessions. You see Apocalypse Now listed in red, because what on earth are we to make out of that? So hopefully this course will be up in the summertime if things proceed. But in the meantime, what we have to look forward to next is session 5, which will deal with The Godfather and The Godfather Part 2. So I hope to hear from those who have ideas and interpretations, but also please tell us how you're doing. I wish everyone the best, and please remember, just keep swimming. My best to you. Thank you very much, and we hope to see you soon for our next session.